Hello everyone, welcome to our data interpretation video series brought to you by Learning Made Easy team, a team of IIM grads in association with our e-learning partner GTCUBE Get to the Top. This is the first part of the series where we will talk about the tabular data. So if you're watching this video in the YouTube channel, do check out our full length courses available for free at gtcube.com/store, where you'll get to watch these videos as part of a course and also get to practice a lot of questions on these concepts that would help you to understand the concepts better. So let's get started. So first let's understand what is data, and then we'll get to what is tabular data. So the whole world is filled with data, right? If you've been living in this current year's generation, I would say you would have been hearing the words about the data, data science, data analytics, analysis, etc., 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 right? Even though we have not realized, even if you have not realized, I would say, most of us would have realized by now, we are sort of living in a world where we use a lot of data, you know, a lot of information being talked, which is what we process, what we think, what we, you know, use to communicate most of the important information. So for example, let's assume that there are two shops in a town, shop A and shop B, and sales information of these two shops for the last 5 years has been recorded. Shop A sold 300 units, 250 units, 400 units, 200 and 100 units in the last 5 years. That's basically 2015, 16, 17, 18 and 19 respectively. This is a piece of information I have about Shop A sales for the last 5 years. Similarly, for Shop B sold 250, 300, 200, 150 and 400 in the last 5 years, 2015 to 2019 again. Again, that is another piece of information I have. So all these pieces of information, we call them as data, right? So what is tabular data? I have a piece of information. This piece of information is basically, you know, in a way can be called as a caselet or something, right? I am talking in a paragraph or a textual way. Similarly, I can represent the same thing in a tabular data, you know, which is a bit easier for me to grasp or maybe to read, understand, then see long passages, you know, go through the words and the numbers combined way. So what would that look like? Something like this. So if I say that sales of Shop A and Shop B for the last 5 years is the title of the table. Okay, I understand that we're talking about the sales for these two shops for the last 5 years. And then years 2015, 16, 17, 18, 19. The Shop A, I see units. Okay, we are talking about units. So Shop A sold 300 units in 2015. Shop B sold 250 units in 2015. Right. Similarly, in 2016, Shop A sold 250, Shop B sold 300, 400 in 2017 for Shop A and 200 for Shop B in 2017, 200 for Shop A in 2018 and 150 for Shop B in 2018. Similarly, 100 for Shop A in 2019 and 400 for the Shop B in 2019. You know, same piece of information which we have talked about in these two lines, we are sort of putting them in a tabular form. You know, this is the tabular data. So you'll get to see the information sometimes being presented in this way as well in our normal life. If you're talking about the data interpretation questions in the exams that we look at, yes, that is also one of the potential way of giving the piece of information so that we can read and answer the given questions. So what are the basic skills required to do good in these questions, the data interpretation questions as a whole? The first and foremost important skill is that we should be able to read and interpret the given data. You know, we talk about the tabular data, graphs like line graphs, bar graphs, pie charts, multiple graphs, etc., etc. So you should be able to read the data visualized form so that the visualization that you get to see like a bar graph or line graph, we should be comfortable in reading the information and interpret in the right way and also the faster way so that we can actually solve the questions better. Once we could actually read the information, the next important skill is basically understanding the question being given. I see some of the students struggling to, you know, understand what's being asked in the question. Yes, I understand the entire piece of information being talked in the graphs or the tables, etc. But then I'm sort of confused about what to do with the question. You know, that's because the way they frame the sentences, they are sort of confused, what should I do now? And most importantly, once you figure that out, you have to be very quick with the calculations. You know, the faster you are, you'll get the answer in a quicker manner. Even though you're not fast, you'll still get the answer. But I would not consider that to be doing good in these questions. That is, like, if you take 3 minutes to do a question, it might not be sufficient depending on which exam you're looking at, right? And also the time that you have in that exam. So I strongly recommend you to also understand that you should be good at the calculations. It would really help you as a whole, you know, depending on what exams you're looking at, being quick with the calculations. You know, how quick you are, there is a, you know, way to measure it, but being decent enough is what I recommend, that you should not take more than 5 to 10 seconds to multiply 2 by 2 or 2 by 3 sort of, you know, numbers. Add, subtract in faster, like less than 5-10 seconds. That's something that I would consider to be good. You can do it faster using some techniques, Vedic maths, etc. That's okay. I'm not asking you to go to that level. But you should be quicker with the normal techniques. But you should not take like half minute, 1 minute to do a 2x2 multiplication. Right? So, what type of questions are being asked, right? As I said, that students do get confused. I see normal students being confused with the questions. What to do? How should I do it? That's because of the way the question is being framed. What I generally say is convert the English into math so that you can actually solve them in an easier manner. You see, this is one of the set of standard type of questions that you would see basically focusing on the percentages. For example, what percent of the shop A's sales in 2015 is shop B's sales in 2018? So, people can read this table. Good. Shop A sales in 2015 is 300. Shop B sales in 2018 is 150. I can read both of that. Good enough. But what should I do now? What is this percentage? What percent should I calculate? So I would say convert, as I said, math into English. So read this word by word. It is saying what percent. So I need to answer this. You know, what percent? 10%, 5%, 7.5%, something like that. Let me take the answer for what is X. I am saying X is the answer for the what. So I just need to find the X. X percent of, right, this is the shop A's sales in 2015 is all one value basically. The shop A's sales in 2015, that is 300. Right? So X percentage of 300 is, are, was, were, is basically equals to shop B sales in 2018, that is also one value basically. How much did shop B sell in 2018? That's 150. This is what the statement looks like. Simple, X percentage should be written as X by 100 of is into 300 is equals to 150. 350 is there, so basically X is 50. So the answer is 50% of shop A sales in 2015 is shop B. You see, I took X is the answer for this. So that's why I would get X as 50, not 50%. So technically it's 50% of the shop A sales in 2015 is shop B sales in 2018. Right? Other way is, by what percentage did the sales of shop A change in 2015 over 2018? So this is not actually a right way of setting a statement, to be frank. You see, 2015 over 2018 is like chronologically it is, but then we wanted to make you understand that I see a common confusion in most of the students. So I see, what is this question asking? The percentage change is what they're asking. I see 2015 for shop A and 2018 for shop A. What is the, what are the values? 2015 300, 2018 200. 2015 it is 300 and this is 200. So one way, what is the formula that I would always recommend is this, you know, the final value, the percentage change for two values minus initial or the base value by initial value in 200, right? So I see students getting confused over this. When they see two elements, they sort of always think the small, larger minus smaller by smaller into 100 is one way they look at it. Or in the chronological order, they do 2018 minus 2015 by 2015 into 100. The value of 2018 year, 2015 and by 2015. All of these are actually the wrong things, right? Always understand what the statement is being framed. The formula for percentage change is going to be this. It's all about finding what is the final value and what is my initial or the base value according to the given question. You see, the question is asking the percentage change for shop A in 2015 over this. So this is my initial or base value, right? Over what? The percentage change is always calculated over some base value or base reference. So because over 2018, so 2018 is my base value or my initial value. And obviously this would be my final value. So as I said, 300 minus 200 by 200 into 100 is the answer. 100 by 200 into 100 will be again 1 by 2 into 100 is 50%. The percentage change is 50%. This would have been, the correct statement would have been, by what percentage, what percentage is the shop A sales in 2015 more or less than 2018. And even then it's again talking about the base being 2018. So accordingly I should do the same thing. What percentage of the total sales of shop A over the last 5 years is 2016 sales? So again, this is similar to the first statement. What percentage, I don't know, I'll take it as X percentage of the total sales of shop A over the last 5 years. What is this value? I have to just find the sum of them. The total sales of the shop over the last 5 years is 300 plus 250, 550, 400, 950, 1150, 1250. Right? So X percentage of 1250 is, are, was, were, as I said, equals to 2016 sales. What is the value for 2016 sales for shop A? It's 250. It's 250, right? It's again easy. X by 100 into 1250 equals to 250. If you know it, you'll do 25. 5s are 125, so that's basically 250. 5s are 1250, 520s are. So X is 20%. That's why I said, like, if you're fast with the calculations, you can actually get the answer much faster. You wouldn't actually have to do all of this also once you, are comfortable with the calculations. So the answer would be 20% for this. But as I said, it's not about the calculations. I am more focusing on this element of how to convert the given question into a simple math equation which you are comfortable with and then solve it. The next set of type is, next set of questions is on the fractions and ratios. Right, something by something. That's very clear that these type of questions expect you to do something divided by something. The complexity is this, that what should be divided by what? Is it A by B or B by A? People always figure out what is A, what is B. They're confused, should I actually do A by B or B by A for most of the times. That's why, again, let's read this one example by example so that I'll help you to convert the English to math. What fraction of the shop B sales for the last 5 years is shop B sales in 2016? Similar to what we did for the percentage, I don't know what fraction, so I need to answer that. Let me take the fraction as X of shop B sales for the last 5 years. What is shop B sales for the last 5 years? I don't know. I need to sum it up. 250 plus 300, 550, 750, 900 plus 400, 1300. So X of 1300 is, R was, were equals to shop B sales in 2016. The shop B sold 300. So that's basically, I need to replace this with 300. This 1300 is the shop B sales for the last 5 years. Is equals to shop B sales in 2016 is 300. So X of 1300 is X into 1300 equals to 300. So X is equals to 300 by 1300. Right? So the fraction is 3 by 13. Simple. Again, what is ratio of shop B sales in 2018 to shop A sales in 2016? Whenever I see this, right, what is ratio of A to B is basically asking me to do A divided by B, or A is to B, as simple as it. So what is the ratio of shop B sales in 2018 to shop A sales in 2016? Shop B sales in 2018 is what? 150. And shop A sales in 2016 is 250. Right? See this, shop A sales in 2016 is 250. So it's basically asking me to do 150 is to 250 is shop A sales in 2016. So it's basically 150 by 250 is 3 is to 5, right? 53 is 55 there. So 3 by 5, 3 is to 5, whatever it is. What is the ratio of lowest sales of shop B for the last 5 years to the highest sales of shop A for the last 5 years? So this is another type of question where they sort of talk about the maximum, minimum, smallest, least value, lowest value, highest value, largest value, etc. So it sort of asks you to first understand from the given information where I can find the lowest or the smallest or the highest or the maximum value, and accordingly find that ratio. So the question is to find the ratio of lowest sales of shop B for the last 5 years. So first let me answer that. So shop B sales for last 5 years are these. What is the lowest value? 150. So the answer for the lowest sales of shop B for the last years is 150. Two, highest sales of shop A for last 5 years. So I need to answer this part of the question first. So highest sales of shop A for the last 5 years is 400. So as simple as that. So it's 150 is to 400, 150 by 400. 3058, so 3 is to 8 or 3 by 8 is the answer. The third type is the averages, finding the mean. Sometimes you might also get to see other part of the central measures of tendency like the median, mode, etc. We'll talk about that as well. So what is the average of something? If I say what is the average of three values like A, B, C, if I know the values are A, B, and C, the average is just sum up those values, and number of values is 3, so I need to do 3, right? That's how I calculate the average, if you don't know that. So what is the average number of units sold by shop B for the last 5 years? I need to figure out the units sold by shop B for last 5 years, year on year, and then do the average. That's basically shop B, right? So shop B, I know that they sold 250, 300, 200, 150, 400. The sum is 1300. So the sum of 5 years, if I do individually, like 2015 year plus 16, 17, 18, 19, by, I need to divide by 5 years because these are 5 years. So it is 1300 is the sum of units sold in the 5 years, right? By 5, so it will be 260 is the average value, 260 units. What is the difference between average number of units sold by shop A and shop B for the last 5 years? I know the average of shop B, 260 units. Similarly, the sum was 1250 for shop A by 5, so it should be 250 units. So the difference of that would be 260 minus 250 is, that's the average, right? Shop B average minus shop A average, that's basically 10 units. That's the difference between the average of shop A and shop B. What is the median number of units sold by shop B for the last 5 years? So if you don't know how to calculate the median of a set of numbers, then you will struggle for this. So it's basically, median is the 50th percentile, right? The middlemost value. I need to arrange it from the smallest to largest, whatever the set of values I have, and then pick the middlemost value. So if I have five values, like in this case, I need to pick the middle value. That's basically 5 plus 1 by 2, 3, third value. If I had 6 values, then it would be average of 6 by 2, that's the third, and the next is fourth. So third and fourth term averages would give me the median for the 6 values, right? But because it's for 5 values, so let me first look at this. So I need to find the median number of units for shop B. So let me do here. What is the smallest? 150, next 200, 250, 300, and 400, right? So this is the smallest, so this is the largest value in terms of number of units sold year on year. As I said, 5 values, so 5 plus 1 by 2, 6 by 2 is third value is my median. So 1, 2, and 3, so this is my median value. So 250 units is the median number of units sold for the by shop B for the last 5 years. Right, another important skill, as I said, right, being quick with the calculations. Learn the art of approximation to increase your speed. That is, you know, for most of the questions in data interpretation, you don't really have to calculate the value to the last decimal point or the last digit. You can get away with doing with a decent approximation and, you know, get the answer in much shorter time. If you see, right, if the answer is, let's say, 250 by 750 into 100. Right, as this is the percentage, okay, let's assume so. This is 251s are 253s are 3 into 33.333. That is something, if you're comfortable with the calculations, you will do it fast. So 33.33% is the answer. So this is fair enough. Let's say, what if I have something like 243 divided by 786 into 100? Then you see something like this. Now trying to figure out how to calculate, you know, and do them 24300 and then dividing something like this, right? Let me do this for 786 into 3. This 36 is 18, 25, 23, 2358, minus 2430, so it should be 42. So it should be 1, it will be 142. Sorry, my bad. 2430, right? It's my bad, sorry, 72. It's only 72. So it's 720, so 30 point. So again, 7200, I do 9 times and blah, blah, blah. So this is going to be really taking a lot of time, right? 30.9%. Rather, what I would say is this. Look at the options. If the options are like 30 point something, 40 point something, 20 point something, and then, you know, 50 point something. These are distributed, you know, far enough for me to actually do the simple approximation like this. 243 into 100, right? So I would rather see this as 24/78. So I've just skipped this last unit, is it right? If you are comfortable with this, 24 ones are 24, threes are 72. I'll have 60, so 3 point something is what I'll get, right? I don't even care what that is, like it will be 3.3, 3.25 or something. I won't count that, let me say, I'll stop it here. 100 by 3 is 33.33%. 100 by 3 point something, which is larger than 3, should give me something less than 33.33%. That should be closer to 30%. You know, that's the only thing I'll approximate. I won't take my time to actually figure out what would that be. Right, what did I say? See, 100 by 3 is 33.33. 100 by 2, when I have smaller denominator, the value should be larger, right? So if I have 100 by 4, it should be 25. So I have something like 100 by 3.5. What should my value be between this 25 and 33.33? So I will approximate it to be 29 or 30, right? So something like this, 1 by 3.2, also 100 by 3.2, also I'll say it's approximately 30. 31% or maybe something like that. See the options. If you have options like 30.5, 31, 31.5, then yes, I understand that you have to do something like this, you know, get to the closer approximation of what I said of skipping this might actually lead you to get plus or 2 points, minus 2 points difference, which could be a problem in these options. But the probability of seeing options like this is very low in exams. Trust me, push yourself to approximate stuff. And you'll be able to solve things much faster and, you know, save a lot of time in this section. I'll show this with all the examples that I show or solve where there is a scope for approximation. I'll explain how we can approximate and, you know, it might take a bit of time. It might make you get something wrong in the beginning, but that's okay. Unless you do it maybe 50 times, 100 times, you don't start to appreciate it, get the technique of it, right? Slowly you'll realize and figure that out and it will come to you intuitively. So don't worry that. Now, if you're not able to do it, if you're able to do it now itself, you really understood what I'm talking about. That's brilliant. Start using it if you're not using it. If you're already using it, that's great. Nothing more to know on this part. Go ahead and start, continue using the same techniques. So let's look at a simple sample set on tabular data. We'll solve this. As I always recommend, pause the video and read through this information. Attempt the question at the end of this. I hope you have passed and tried it. So let's see. So the following table shows the production of food grains in million tons in a state for period 1999 to 2000 to 2003-2004. So it's for each year 1999 to 2000, 2000-2001, 2001-2002. So I have for 5 years, I have the production of food grains in a state for wheat, rice, barley and other cereals. You know, whatever the quantity is, million tons. So they have given us these individual quantities. The question is asking, in 2002 to 2003, the percentage increase in production of barley as compared to the previous year was, as I said, right? So 2002 to 2003 for barley compared to the last year. What is the last year? 2001 to 2002. What is the production of barley in 2002 to 2003? 380. 2001 to 2002, it is 320. So, again, as I said, the question is asking for the percentage change. I know final value minus initial value by initial value into 100 is the formula. That's good. Now, I need to just figure out what is final and what is initial. What is the final value and what is the initial value? You see, production of barley in 2003, right? In 2002 to 2003, the production of barley as compared to the previous year. So, this is my initial value. The reference is this. Over previous year, how much has it increased, has changed? That's the question. So this is my initial value and this is my final value. Right, so it will be 380 minus 320 by 320 200. It will translate to be 60 by 320 into 100. It will come to be 600 by 32. You see, I know 600 by 30 is what? 20%. So 600 by 32 will be slightly less than 20%. You know, I'll put it 18% or etc. With this, I can straight away cut these two options. But the problem in this question is that they have two options which are pretty close by, which is sort of pushing us to know it. By chance, let's assume there was no option, you know, like let's assume there's third option, whichever is the wrong answer, with something like 22 or 10 or 12, etc. I can straight away mark them out and pick the right option. You know, I can save a lot of time by just doing this. But because I have two options like this, so let me do this. 600 by 32 is 4150s are, 48s are, 24s are, 275s are. Right, this will be 14875. So this will be 18.75 is the answer. Right, I'm sort of taking a bit of time in this because the options are pretty close. But sort of if there was no option which is pretty close like this, there were no options like that, then I could have simply approximated 600 by 32 is closer to 20%. But I need to realize it is slightly less than 20 because it's not 600 by 30, it's 600 by 32. The denominator is slightly more, so the value will be slightly less than 20, like something like 18% or so, 18 point something. So just the answer is 18.75. Right. So next question is, we'll see four questions on the same piece of information with the minor change in the question. The change in the questions at the end. During the period 1999 to 2003 to 2004, that's basically over the 5 years, X percentage of the total production is production of wheat. The value of X is about. So it's basically saying the same, right? X percentage of the total production is wheat for the 5 years, this entire time period, right? I don't know the, I know only the individual values, I don't know the total values, right? So let me first sum it up. It's a bit tedious problem, to be fair. 680 plus 800, 1480 plus 680 will be 2160. 2160 plus 720 is 2880, 3700. 270 plus 420 is 690, 690 plus 350 is 740, 1040, 1440, 2000. 250 plus 440 is 690, 710, 1010, 1090, 1390, 1800. 750, 810, 1210, 1710, 1710, 1800 plus 600 is 2400. Right. These are my individual sums. So you see, the slower you are in adding up stuff, more time you will take, right? If you have the habit of doing 0 plus 0 plus 0, I'll write 0. 8 plus 8, 16 plus 2, 18 plus 2, 20. I'll put 2 here. 10, 17, 23 plus 8, 31 plus 6, 37. You know, you do stuff like this, you will take a bit more time. But it's okay if you're taking a little bit more time as long as you get the right answer. See, the order of priority should be first get it right. Right, and then, you know, get it fast. No merit in getting it wrong even though you do it in 10 seconds. That's absolutely useless, right? So sort of prioritize getting it right. So it's okay even if you're taking a bit of time in adding up, calculating stuff. But don't push yourself to get it wrong. But while you learn, it's good to push yourself so that, you know, you push yourself to tune your brain to do it fast. So that slowly you'll also start to get it right and fast. So push yourself. It's okay to get it wrong sometimes when you're trying to, you know, do it fast. Right. In the exams, I'm saying that understand your real pace when you are closer to the real exam you're taking and make sure that you sort of only push to that level. Don't try to be smarter by doing faster in 10 seconds in the real exam if you're not a person at that level. Right. While you're practicing, it's good to practice so that you get to that level. So what is the total production? 3700 plus 1800 is 5500, 7500 plus 2400 is 9900. Right, so that's basically saying X percentage of 9900 is equals to 2000, sorry, wheat, right? So that's 3700. So X is 3700 by 9900 into 100. I'll cancel this. 9900 also same, so I'll take this to be 37. Now there's a problem. Is it 37 point something or 37, you know? Now it's easy, right? Cut off this. So should it be this or this? I got 37 by 99 into 100. right? If I got 37 by 100 into 100, it would have been simply 37%. Because my new denominator is 99, which is less than 100, the whole value should be greater than 37. So the answer would be, okay, both of them are above 37, right? So if there was an option, at least it was less than 37, more than 37, we could have saved time. I think the option looks like this would be the correct one, this one. But I'll show you the calculations. I'll also tell you why I think that's the answer. I've approximated again. So I'll tell you this. So 37 by 99, right? So 3 there, so that will be 397, 397, 7 9 is 63, 730, 37, 7 9 is 63, 7 693, so that will be 37, 370, so you'll get 37 by 37, 37, 37, so on. If I keep doing it, I'll get 37.37, 37, so the answer is 37.4. So why did I say that it will be this, then this? You see, this is 37 by 99, this is 37 by 100 gives me 37, right? So this is 1 unit less than 100, so each unit would be 0.37. That's why 100 units will be 37 units. So that's why I felt, because I have 1 unit less, it should be 37.4. So 37 plus 37. It's okay if you didn't understand what I'm talking here, this 1 unit 0.37 part. 37 units I converted into 100 units, that is each unit will be 0.37, and 99 units will be, you know, according to that I was talking about this. But it's okay. Even if you do this, it's okay. The chance of seeing options close to this level is very low in exams. It just depends on, you know, the way the options are set. So we've you know, pick the option so that we sort of show the approximation, also show that it will not always work, right? But it will work for most of the cases. Don't stop doing that approximation. The next question: in the year 2003 to 2004, the percentage increase in production over the previous year was highest for, you know, now I'm looking at these four in 2003 to 2004 over the previous year, right? So 820, 720. So the changes over the previous year. So 2002 to 2003 will be my base value. So 720, 100, 200. That is option A. Sorry, that is wheat. What about rice? 160 is the change by 400 into 100. What about barley? 380 to 410, that's 30 up. By 380 into 100. And what about other cereals? 190 change by 500 into 100. You see, no merit in doing certain things. I don't really want to know what's this value, okay? See here, approximation will work a lot. What is this? I don't know what this is, but I will say this is 1 is to 7. Okay, 100, 7 is 700, 100 by 7 will be approximately 14 point some percent. Right, this will be approximately 40%, and this will be, I don't know how much it is, this will be approximately 13 3s are 390, so 100 by 13 will be close to 7 to 8%. 13 7s are 91, so it will be close to 7 to 8%, and this will be 190 by 5, so this will be closer to 38%. You see, I did not waste my time by calculating what is this, what is this, because they are very far off from these two options. Right, so here if I have done a lot of approximation, if I get two options to be very close, then I'll sort of go back and calculate only those two options again. No merit in, you know, finding what is this 14.3 something something, or 13.9, this is 7.58, etc. It's useless to find that, right? It's waste of our time. If straight away eliminated these two options and we can, you know, select between these two, the answer will be this option, that is rice. If you are someone who is very comfortable with the percentages, you could actually do this. 820 by 720, that's for the wheat, right? Whatever the value I get will be something like 1 point something. If I get, right, 1.14 should be what I should be getting ideally. So that means it is 14% up. Okay, if you knew this, okay, I'm just talking about this. For example, this is, right, 560 by 400. This will be 414 there, so that's 1.4. 562 by 400 is 1.4, that's 40% up. 1.4 minus 1 into 100, 0.4 into 100 is 40%. Now that's how we can also do it. It's basically the same percentage change. I have this habit of doing it. I strongly recommend you to do it. So how do I do it? The percentage change can be done by doing directly final value by initial value. you'll get 1 point something or 0 point something. If I get, let's say, final value, initial value is 0.8, what is this? How much is it less than 1? 0.2, minus 0.2, right? So it is basically minus 20%, decrease of 20%. If I get 1.2 as the ratio final by initial, it means it is 20% up, that is rise. If I get 1.34, it is 34% up. Now that's how I can approximate. You know, that's how I can calculate the percentage change directly. But if you are not comfortable with it, don't worry. Stick to the formula I've said, final minus initial by initial into 100. That will work. That's like the basic one. This is slightly advanced. That will come from the basic formula only. But if you are not clear with it, don't worry. Stick to the basic. The difference of average production of rice and the average production of the barley over the years is, right? So I need to find the average. So this is focusing on the average, the production of rice. So I already know this is 2000. If you remember, right, I have calculated the values here. 2000 barley is 1800. So the barley sum is 1800. So what is the average for 5 years? So 2000 by 5 will be 400. 1800 by 5 will be 360. So the difference is 400 minus 360 is 40 tons, 40 million tons. The answer is option D. Right? That's how you can solve this. So that's it. Thank you for watching this video. If you're watching this video in the YouTube channel, do check out our full length courses available for free at gtcube.com/store, where you'll get to watch these videos as part of the course and also get to practice a lot of questions that will help you to understand these concepts better. Also, like our partner's Facebook page, facebook.com/gtcube3. We're coming up with a lot of courses and content for different exams that would help you to, you know, crack these exams. So do follow this page so that you get all those notifications and updates. Thank you for watching this video, and let's meet in the next video.